Here's my experimental circuit. I've got one of these, it's a reflective mode infrared detector. The clear one, the clear LED is an infrared emitter, the red LED is an infrared detector, and the board just handles all the magic. It's got a sensitivity adjustment, power LED, and an activated LED. It's got three pins, 5 volts ground, and an output. The output goes low, goes to ground, when it detects something. I've just got that plugged into a breadboard just for convenience. Got an LED and a resistor on the output. And then to power it, just for portability, I've got this little 5-volt boost converter. Take anything from 1 volt up to 5 volts and boost it up to a nice steady even 5 volts, up to a reasonable amperage. And then I've got just a battery with a couple magnets on it. Boom, power. Okay, so let's desensitize this a little bit because it's detecting all my lights. No, let's put a little condom over the detector so that it can't see quite as much. Okay, there. I give it something to shine on. You see the little activated light comes up. And also my LED down there. Can you see it? I'm not sure of the lights. Anyway, so that's my test rig. I'm going to bury that in the track somehow, so that it can detect what's rolling over top of it. So to get started, I've drilled a couple of holes in the roadbed between these two ties here, and then cleaned it out. Okay, so I drilled a couple of holes through there, and then just to clean it out, I took this coping saw blade and just ground away until I got more of a slot in there. That's the full width between the ties. Here's where it gets a little bit ugly. I have to widen out the holes to be wide enough to fit the detector, which means 3/4 inch spade bit, and try not to drill up and mangle the track. Well, that didn't work out so good. Guess this means I get to demonstrate track laying. I thought I was done with that. I gathered up a few things. A replacement piece of track, which is longer than what I need, so that's good. A few track nails. They're just little tiny box nails in my case. Pliers to pull the old spikes out. And we need a way of cutting the rails. A pair of Zeron rail nippers would be really good in this case if they happen to have any. I don't, so Dremel. Because I haven't learned anything about power tools yet tonight. So this here I'm cutting just, actually that one I cut in the gap. But the other rail I'm going to cut just shy of the gap, and I'm going to desolder the rail joiner later. There's the messed up piece. Won't need that anymore. Peel some of these ties out of here. Oh, need another nail. So, now that, as I was mentioning before, I have to desolder that, so I'm going to use a soldering iron that's older than me. It's my grandfather's soldering iron. It's got about 6 layers of tape on it, and it takes a while to warm up, but it gets really hot, and it's got a bit of thermal mass to it. My little 25-watt soldering iron just won't cut it for this. The reason I want to use something big and ugly like this is just so I can get in and out quickly. This might get hard to see, but I got a little piece out. Because the reason I want to get in and out quickly, there we go, is you don't want to melt the ties. You just want to get that joiner out. There it is. Okay. Well, I did do a number on that, didn't I? I think I'm going to leave this staggered over here so the joins aren't right parallel to each other, just for a little bit of strength, which means when I cut this, I'm going to have to cut it staggered. Another jump cut there to go get more tools. I'll just make a slice on either side of the eruption here. Oh my. Okay, so I'll scrape that down nice and smooth underneath where the cork's gonna go. I was prepared, I'd have everything right handy, but I'm not, so there's going to be about 100 more jump cuts before this is done. So straight edge. This would probably be best done on a workbench, but where's my nick here? I'll sand that down a little bit, make it fit. Who knew it would be so hard to actually work on your layout while you're demonstrating it. Okay, it's close enough, but that's still got square edges. But then I snap it like I was talking about before. There we've got a kind of angled bevels. Flip it around like that. There. So, clean that out. This still isn't perfect, but I'll trim it a little bit more once it's in there and once the glue is dried. So, the point of this exercise was to put the signaling detector in there, wasn't it? So, before I glue that in, I'm just get a Sharpie here. And where's the hole? Okay, where's that? That's all in place. Draw a little hole. And cut a slot out of that. So that's going to stick up there. It's going to be down below the ties. And then as trains or anything else comes by, it's going to reflect and be detected. Now then, when I originally laid this down, I used contact cement just because it was nice and quick and it's flexible. I couldn't find any during that last little break there, so I will use white glue. Whoa, that's way too much. This white glue sticks to all the materials that I'm using here. There's a little gap underneath there. That's not going to be the end of the world. Okay. White glue. Oops. That's the off cut. Poke that down into there. This is all going to get hidden under the ballast anyway. So its job is to hold the track, prevent vibrations. I need some weight on that. What have I got here? That'll do. And some metal stamps. There, that'll weight it down, make it nice and smooth across there. If I had one of those cool little cartoon time passes things, I would use it here. But I don't. So while that glue is drying, you can't really see back here, but I've pulled off a couple more ties past where it was cut off, just to give me some room to put the joiner on. And then with those pieces of ties, I've just snipped off the pieces that strap them together. See, on this flex track, there's little stringers of plastic that join one side all the way across and the other side every second tie together, which lets it flex. But I need a handful of just single ties to put underneath the joiners and underneath the areas where I'm going to be cutting the ties back, like over there. The reason I want them as singles is so that they'll actually slide underneath the rails easier. And in order to do that, I need to cut off the molded on spike detail. How am I going to do this so that you can actually see what's going on? Piece of paper here. Well, that's not useful. How about that? Is that neutral enough? So there's one of the ties. You can see that sort of three-dimensional detail of the spikes and fish plate. I'm gonna tie plate. I'm gonna just use my knife and cut some of those off so that I can slide it under the rail this way. After the rail's in place, I'm going to leave it on just one side. There's four little details. I'm going to leave just one of them on, the one on this side, the aisle side. I'll slide it in that way, and that last one will bump up against the outside edge there so that it's visible, but the other three won't because they're not there, so they'll slide underneath. Yes, cutting towards my fingers. There, so now then, I'll be able to just take it and just slide it under, and it'll bump up, and from the aisle side, it'll look like nothing ever happened. Inside here, it'll be slightly visible, but the ballast should hide that kind of sins. So I'm just going to prepare a few more of these and wait another few hours for the glue to dry. Time has passed. Glue is dried. Let's get back to this. Actually, since I've got this, nice and level, good. Yes, the machinist square is just a wee bit overkill for that. So it goes. So now then, trim these down a little bit. Spike this guy back into the approximate curve just temporarily. And I'm going to mark it a bit long. Because it's always easier to make it shorter later. You mentioned earlier, I could use one of those Zeron rail nippers if I had one, but I don't. So, just for convenience, even that up and cut it straight across. That's just for laziness more than anything. There, back cut. I'll just use the files, just clean up the joining areas here a little bit. This end is actually not the end that I just cut. However, this end did have some solder on it from some previous time. So I'm just going to clean that up a little bit, so the rail joiner will slip on. And then at the end that I did cut, there's a flat surface file, whatever. The ends that I did cut, just touch them up a little bit so that the joiner slides on smoothly. Okay, so that's that. Now, joiners. Do I have any that actually snapped loose or no? Okay, well. Okay. Slide that guy into there about half-ish way. Same again, bending, fatiguing. Okay. So now let's just slip in there. I will eventually solder them. Now then, these guys that I intentionally kept along. Yep. I don't know why I wasted my time cleaning them up, because I'm just going to have to cut them again. But now I can mark them a little bit closer, I think, to where they're really going to go. This is another one of those three-hander jobs. And you can't see what I'm doing again. But I'm just lining them up along the curve, making my marks. Give that a cut, same as before. I'm just going to go and clamp it down and saw it because I don't, well, I don't care if this gets chewed up, but I'm just vibrating everything. Back in a minute. Give it a little bit of a cleaning, deburring. It really doesn't take much. It's a fairly soft material. And then once I've got it fully joined, I'm going to give it just, I'll solder it. And I'll just give it another quick little touch up here. I'm not even on camera. There, that end's touched up. Back into those joiners. So these joiners, the more times you... There we go. That looks pretty good. So I just slip some joiners on there now. Now this one is going to be a bit of a bear to get in. So what I'll do is slip them onto the end that's easier to get into, which is these two here. Again, with the camera obscured, I'll just, okay, I've got those two slipped on, and they're slipped on all the way. Now then I can just line this back up, shadows and all. Line it back up and then grab onto the joiner and just slide it on so that the joiner is just kind of centered 50-50 on each side. There we go. That's that in place. There's teeny little gaps in there, like business card thickness gaps. Not a big deal. Okay, so I got one spike hole there. Just gonna pilot drill. And oh, I so lucked out here. Right here. Where I want to put those LEDs, that little slot that I left. Check this out. The slot's right where I wanted it. I don't have to dick around with these ties. That's excellent. So I'm just gonna punch him down into the hole that I need. The hole that I didn't really make all that well. But I'm going to drop a few more in too. So you can see there's not really a kink, it's a relatively smooth curve into there. That's what I'm talking about. Nice there. I think the gauge is a little tight over here. Hang on. I have an NMRA gauge. Oh, it's super reflective. Can you even see it? Anyway, this bit down here is to check that the track is not too narrow, not too wide. it should slide easily through. And so if the track's too narrow, like this one became, it pinches in there. And if the track's too wide, like that exaggerated a bit there, so or here it's too pinches in narrow, but then see it, this little pin here, point here, falls off the edge into the gutter. That's too wide. So they were back to reasonable. And actually that I can feel is jamming. So that's too narrow right there. Then you're going to get out here and it falls into the gutter. That's too wide. So I'm going to try that over there. Not sure where I was when the battery died, but I'm just going to go through here and okay, that's a little tight there. I'll just bend it out a little bit. That's better. Okay, soldering gun's all warmed up. So basically, like I was saying when I was desoldering, the trick is to get in there with lots of heat, quickly, not melt the ties, and then get back out. And I'm going to solder this just on the outsides of the rail, not the inside. I'll do this side first. Get that out of the way. This side first, just because it's easier to see. And the reason I'm doing the outside of the rails only and not the inside is because I don't want to foul the flange. I'll try and get it to suck down into the rail joiner. Same again down here. I'm going to zoom in on that one for your convenience and viewing pleasure. Silly me, I let off the trigger. Well, we all got heat. This one I can warm up a little bit more. Because there's no ties anywhere near it. So the joiners are making the mechanical connection. The solder itself has to make the electrical connection. And this has to get down in there. Once it's hot, it'll suck down inside the joiner a little bit. The flux will help it flow in. And then I'll clean that up with the files. So I'll just clean off the rail head because it's got some flux on it and the solder. Clean up the inside just to make it nice and smooth because of the cut in the join. Right now I'm not filing the joiner, I'm filing just the inside of the rail head. I want this to be a nice smooth transition right here, and currently it isn't. Thank you. I want the wheels to be able to go through there as if there isn't a joint at all. And then, so there is a little drop in there, but that's okay. I can live with that. But that's good. And then this other one is going to take a bit more cleaning up. Again, clean the flux off the railhead. Clean the inside face, because that's where the flange of the wheel rides. And that's where it's going to cause problems with derailments. If that's going to be an issue. That's nice. Yeah, the gauge is still tight there. It's just from the gauge is tight from about there. Right there, so that area there. I'll clean that afterwards. But it's just a matter of fiddling with it a little bit until until it comes right. Let's get it a little bit closer to the center. Rattle, rattle. Put that in there. Friction is going to hold it a little bit and glue eventually. When the ballast's in, I wouldn't even need these spikes really. Everything's going to be held nicely together with the ballast glue. But now, the next, am I going to put one more tie in there? Yeah, the next one tie has to go actually under the joiner, which means that tie needs to be thinner than the rest. The answer to that is to just thin them down without dropping them. Because you got the extra thickness of the rail joiner underneath there. That should be close enough. So you don't want to create a bump in the track. You can see it's actually bumping up there when I'm trying to shove that under. Let's see what happens. There, and those are just there with friction right now. The ballast glue is going to hold it, and actually, where's the straight edge here? That's good, actually. I'll check this one over here while I'm at it. That's good vertically. I'm going to spend some more time back here tweaking that up. Now I've got the area worked out and smoothed out the way I want it to be. The ties are in. The roughness is dealt with. Now, let's see how smooth it is. That's what I wanted to see. And yes, that wasn't the same test car as I was using here earlier. Turns out the car that I was using earlier is actually on the repair track for a reason. Its wheels are bottoming out. There we go. That's what you like to see. No grabs or anything, just runs right through. Beautiful. Okay, now I can get back to... Where did I start this anyway? Oh yeah, right. Putting this guy in there for signaling. So now I can fit it up to there. Up there, and... The LEDs don't quite fit through the hole between the ties. I got my signaling LED there. I've got my photo detector here. So just manually hold this up in the hole. So those are just below the level of the ties. And here's what's supposed to happen when a train comes by. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The monster lives. So, now all I have to figure out is a bracket that isn't my hand for holding this in the right spot under there. Which shouldn't be that hard, because there's a hole right there for a mounting screw. So, an L bracket of some kind, a non-conductive standoff, and a tiny screw, of which I have a whole drawer full there, so that's not an issue. The biggest issue, though, is not having to do this kind of butchery in the future for every other one that I want to signal. Which means not having to drill that 3/4 inch hole from the bottom. Just drilling a couple of smaller holes through between the ties. I'm gonna have to think on this. Future video, eventually.